As comedy explodes around the world in Montreal, Scotland, and New York City this summer, why did San Francisco not remain the epicenter for stand-up comedy, considering all the great acts who came from the city on the bay? We talk with Will Durst, America's number one political satirist and one of the high priests of the San Francisco comedy scene. We have some fun premium content this week. I wanted Robert Smigel to do Donald Trump because he's famous for doing Donald Trump. And I was going to write something, and then I listened to something we did 3 years ago and thought, you know, we can't top this. So this week's premium content is Robert Smigel doing Donald Trump. $2.50. Premium content. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Hit the premium content button, and you'll see Smigel as Trump. Hysterical. $2.50. If you don't laugh your ass off, I'll give you your money back. You can get all our premium content for free by becoming a monthly subscriber for as little as $5 a month. We take all major credit cards. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Become a monthly subscriber. Join Team Feldo. For only $5 a month, you gain access to all our premium content. Check it out. Welcome a couple of new members to Team Feldo. We always are grateful for people who support this show by listening and by donating money, by becoming monthly subscribers or just donating money, or just by buying some of our premium content. Welcome to Team Feldo, Jonathan Katz, Mark Walgan, Mark Rossbach, Russell Martucci, Nicholas James, William Guthrie, and David Addy. Thank you again, and welcome to Team Feldo. This isn't really work. Will Durst joins us. This is just me talking to a guy who knows all my skeletons and probably got drunk with a few of them. How are you, sir?
I'm still drinking, but not this morning. But last night, I had a gig in Cloverdale, and for some reason, I hooked up with this incredible crew who used to work at the theater. They have a gorgeous little 99-seat, federally funded grant to the city. It's called the Cloverdale Performing Arts Center, a CPAC.
What?
Yeah. Just this great crew of people.
CPAC, the conservative people?
No. Cloverdale Performing Arts Center.
Oh, okay.
CPAC. So, okay. Yeah, the unfortunately named CPAC. But, and so I just hooked up with these guys, and they're having a benefit. And I did my little one-man show about being a baby boomer last year here. And it went over to, I guess, well. And then this year they're having a benefit for the theater, and so they're charging huge amounts of money and giving out hors d'oeuvres and champagne and wine and beer and blah, blah. And then I'm performing, and they wanted a new show. They didn't want the Boomer show. Well, I don't have a new show, you know. So I just patch together stuff, you know, pieces, and new stuff that I'm working on, and more political stuff. And so I did a Durst case scenario last night, and it went well. And so then I hung out drinking with him till like 2:30 in the morning.
By the way, Will Durst, for those of you who are just joining us, has been called possibly America's funniest political satirist by the New York Times. He is the funniest political satirist in America and my hero, and he will be at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival in August. I want to talk to you about that, because that is insane. And we have listeners in Scotland. We do.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
They got to come see my little show.
So tell us about your show, and I want my friends in Scotland to get a pad and pencil, write it down. Where are you? When are you? And what is the name of the show?
The name of the show is Boomer Raging. I'm at the Gilded Balloon in the Wine Bar at 5:30 every day. Every day throughout the entire festival, except Tuesday, August 18th. But otherwise, every day, 5:30 in the afternoon. And I hope it goes well.
What is the Edinburgh Festival? Explain that
to me. The Edinburgh Festival started out in 1947. And it started out as a "Thank God We're Not Speaking German" festival. And they invited the best theater and ballet and symphony and opera companies from around Europe. And, you know, first couple of years were kind of rough, and then everybody jumped in and said, yes, we are the best theater company, and we will be glad to go to Edinburgh. So about 7 years later, cut to the chase. All the theater groups and people in London are going, well, for crumb's sake, there's nobody here. Everybody's in Edinburgh. Let's just rent out a little theater in Edinburgh. And when people get tired of the real festival, maybe they don't want to see highfalutin stuff, and we'll just be on the fringe of the festival. And that's where the whole fringe thing started. And then the fringe got bigger and bigger, and then these guys from Oxford or Cambridge or Oxbridge or whatever they call it, you know, the Cambridge Footlights, and, you know, they have their amateur theatrical things. And they came to Edinburgh for the Fringe Festival, and then they were so good that they were invited back the next year to be part of the actual festival. And they were called Beyond the Fringe. They called that show Beyond the Fringe. Perhaps you remember it. And that was Dudley Moore and Peter Cook and Dr. Jonathan Miller and a couple of other guys. I think there were four or five. And now the Fringe is huge. Every garage space, every, you know, little space in a school is used. And this will be my eighth Edinburgh Fringe Festival.
Wow.
First in 11 years, but I've done, you know, 8 months of my life I will have spent in Edinburgh.
Wow.
All August.
Wow. We're talking Scotland, by the way, so I want all my listeners in Scotland or Ireland or London, and I got to stop calling them my listeners. I'm getting very possessive. But you should go see Will Durst. Tell us again the name of the show and where it's playing.
Yeah, it's called Boomer Raging. It's from LSD to OMG. That's what happens when acid flashbacks meet dementia. And it's at the Gilded Balloon at the Wine Bar at 5:30 every night. Go to wilders.com.
And if you go to the Fringe Festival...
.co.uk.
I'm sorry, say that again. I interrupted you.
Go to wilders.com or gildedballoon.co.uk.
If one were to go to the festival, how many shows could one see?
Well, I used to work at the assembly rooms, so this is what I know. Some assembly rooms had five different spaces, and they had a 500-seat grand ballroom Then they had a 250-seater. Then they had a 150-seater. Then they had a 99-seater. And then they had a 60-seater. And they had five spaces in this one venue. And the 500-seater, you know, only a couple of times a day. But all the other four spaces, from noon until midnight, would run with shows every 90 minutes, a different show. So we're talking like 30 or 40 shows per venue, you know. And then there's like six, seven venues like this. And so I think per day there are 1,200 performances.
Wow. So it's basically Branson with teeth, but really bad teeth. Has that joke been done?
No, I don't think so. Has this joke been done? A civilian gave it to me.
Who?
Has this joke been done?
Who gave it to you?
A civilian.
Okay.
So I don't know if they took it from a real professional.
Yeah, that's a problem usually. Yeah. Go ahead.
The joke is Donald Trump is that kid who fell down a well and then laughs. He didn't tell anybody.
That would work. Yeah, because he does look like Timmy. He's got the hair. Well, or Lassie's hair. He's got somebody's hair.
It works at a couple levels.
I would try it. Have you done it yet?
Yeah, it kills.
Then keep it. I haven't heard that.
Yeah.
There you go.
You got to be careful when civilians give you a line because, you know, they might have heard it from another civilian who might have gotten it from The Tonight Show. You know?
Right. Who might have gotten it from a comedian.
Another comic.
That was I do remember a couple of jokes that I decided to stop doing because I heard Jay had done them. And, you know, Jay, the problem with taking faxers, you know, the Writers Guild has been pretty lax about this. But if you have a talk show, you can have people faxing in jokes from all over the world. And you have to sign a release, and I don't know how it works. And it's good to encourage young writers. The problem is they're not union. And some of them go to comedy clubs to get ideas, to get inspiration. And I noticed, are you still there, sir?
Yeah.
And I noticed.
I totally agree.
Yeah. So I believe in encouraging young comedy writers. And I think faxing in is probably a good way to, I don't know, but maybe it isn't because it's a union, you know, for television shows, it's a union job. And if you have faxers, you should do a better job of hiring your writers. You don't necessarily need faxers. Not to take anything away. I know people are going to get angry because a lot of listeners are budding comedy writers. So I don't want to discourage people.
Let me tell you why I don't watch Jon Stewart or Leno or Fallon or Kimmel or any of those guys. And one of the reasons, there's like three reasons. One reason is I am constantly on the lookout for a new bit or a new line. And I am afraid that something that I see on one of those shows is going to, you know, like DMSO, kind of simmer down into my brain and then bubble up 2 months later, and I'm going to think that it was mine.
Right.
Okay, that's one problem.
Right.
Another problem is that I have seen on these shows a joke that I originated, and it was too idiosyncratic for it to be one of those, you know, reach the same conclusion with the same information at the same time things, which I totally understand, and that can happen. But this was a joke about Dick Cheney detaching his jaw and swallowing Lloyd Benson whole. I mean, it was too close, and it was, and I've been doing it for months, and then I saw it on the Stewart Show, and I got really pissed, and I approached the joke differently now because I thought that the audience was aware, what I was aware, that somebody on TV had done it, and I was projecting on them that they were going to think that I ripped it off, and I was, so I had a whole different attitude about the joke, and it was, it never got the same response because I stutter-stepped it. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't go into it with full confidence. Right. So that's now I'm sure a lot of my stuff is, you know, because what I'm saying about the, you know, the same information entering the same computer, you know, you're going to come up with the same joke. And so, but I don't watch it, so I don't know. So I never have to worry about that.
There are two schools of thought. One was don't watch other comedians. You don't want to be influenced. I think Adam Sandler has that theory. Judd Apatow is an expert on comedy. Told me that when they were starting out, Judd would always be going, oh, go, come look at this guy. Come look at this girl. Come. And Adam said, nah, I don't want to be influenced. Whereas Judd is a complete student, a scholar of stand-up.
Right. Carlin would never, I mean, I don't think Carlin went to movies because he didn't want to be influenced by someone else's version of the vision, you know?
And I feel kind of guilty that I don't watch that much stand-up. So should I feel guilty because somebody said, because I've had these conversations with people and I don't want to be influenced. And honestly, if somebody's really good, I get jealous.
Unless they're
great in a self-destructive way, then I'm not threatened by them. Or they're doing something that I could never even do. But when we were starting out, I didn't watch that much. I remember I would go outside because I didn't want to watch other comics. And I found the ones who watched other comics excessively kind of stalled. And then they became like joke enforcers. They became the comedy police. This bit was stolen. He's doing your bit. And I thought, I don't want to be the comedy police. I don't want to be the... That really locks up your creative process. If you become a joke police officer...
Oh, yeah. There's guys in Austin and Houston who are Bill Hicks policemen. You know, they yelled at Kathleen Madigan for a joke that she did. Yeah, I think a lot of people come to the same conclusion. You know?
I had a joke, and that's why I've never really watched Bill Hicks. I had a joke that I was doing about something about God created the earth in 6 days, and if you, that makes sense because it looks like a real rush job. And, you know, well, and,
that's a funny joke.
Yeah, and then I go to England. This was like, you know, 15 years ago, and everybody's walking up to me going, that's Bill Hicks's joke. And I went, what? And something about God rushing it, like he created the earth. I don't know how the bit goes. So I stopped doing it. But I had to go to England to be accused of stealing.
Chastised.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have a pretty strong Bill Hicks enforcement.
As they should. So you're in Edinburgh.
I wrote a joke in, I think, 92. It's on my cassette. And I did a cassette. It's called None of the Above. And I did a joke. And it was about Pat Buchanan building a wall on the Mexican border. Right? Mm-hmm. And how are we going to build a 1,952-mile-long, 15-foot-high fence on the Mexican border without using Mexican labor? I did that joke like in 1992. Now, fast forward 15 years, suddenly there's a huge argument about who wrote that joke, and I'm not even in the conversation.
Right, right. I mean, Carlos Mencia did that joke, and then Joe Rogan jumped on stage at the Comedy Store 5 years ago and used that joke to expose Carlos Mencia as a thief. That he's, and then I guess I don't remember specifically, but I think Joe attributed it to somebody.
Well, I got it on tape, and it was a commercially produced tape.
Yeah.
People can check.
Well, that's the good thing about Twitter is you can timestamp a joke. You can go back in time and say, I wrote this joke, and there's the date. But I don't get too much traction on Twitter. I get more on Facebook. I find Twitter to be...
Oh, Facebook has changed the algorithms now. It's hard to get any traction out there.
They want you to buy advertising.
Exactly.
Well, so what is a day in the life of a Fringe Festival comedian? You get up at what time? You have a show at 5:30, and you're there for the month? How
Which
long?
Which is very civilized.
Yes. You're there for how long? A month?
For a month, yeah.
30 days.
I arrive on August 3rd, and I leave September 1st.
And is somebody running the festival?
Well, there's a Fringe office. I imagine there's a board and the major players.
Because I always, I've never done...
players in terms of comedy are four. The Gilded Balloon, the Pleasance, the Assembly Rooms, and the Stand.
And those are
so
clubs.
I imagine that they have some, you could, you know, some influence in terms of who sits on the Fringe board. And so the Fringe puts everything together, and then there's a couple of coalitions that they have. And I haven't been there for 11 years, so I don't know.
As opposed to the Montreal Comedy Festival, which is very tight. You know,
going on right now, right?
It's going on right now.
Yeah.
I have never been to the Fringe. I kind of equate it to the Occupy movement. And maybe I'm wrong about that, where it's kind of fluid, amorphous, and anybody can go there as long as they can get a venue. Is that true?
Yes. But breaking out of the clutter, you know, just like today, everything, breaking through the clutter is impossible. And, you know, the major newspapers are all sending reviewers and, you know, but still, there's so many shows. And even comedy, I think there's going to be like 40 comics at this venue that I'm at, you know, 40 different comics, including Proops and a bunch of British heroes, you know, really big time comics. So I don't know if I'll be able to break through the clutter. And the show that I'm doing my Boomer show, but I'm doing a 65-minute version of the 90-minute show. So it's going to be, I think it's going to be jokier, you know, than the real show. It's not going to have the ups and downs of the real show. So, and I don't know if it's going to translate. I don't know if the Boomer experience that I try to portray from America is going to be reflected in, because I'm sure the English Boomer experience was totally different than ours.
They had a couple of booms during the war.
Exactly, and they lost a lot more men than we did.
Yeah,
I think they, you know, we lost what 5% of the guys who went over, and they lost like 20 or something.
God, if you couldn't get laid after World War II. That is like...
Oh, that's a joke that I've heard about Burning Man. You know Burning Man?
Yeah.
This guy is so lame, he couldn't get laid at Burning Man.
Why? Are there so many women there?
It's so sexually free.
Oh, I'm talking about the odds. That there were more...
Yeah, I know.
The odds of women to men. I mean, there must have...
Yeah.
After World War II...
It must have been 5-4 or 4-3 or something, yeah.
For as little as $5 a month, you can gain access to all our premium content by going to davidfeldmanshow.com and becoming a monthly subscriber. We take all major credit cards. Check out this week's premium content. It's Robert Smigel doing Donald Trump from 3 years ago. It's hysterical. It's $2.50. If you don't laugh your ass off, I will give you your money back. $2.50, or get it for free by becoming a monthly subscriber. $5 a month. $5 a month. We accept all major credit cards, and you gain access to all our premium content. We'll be right back. When is Comedy Day? And you sit on the board of Comedy Day.
I'm just on the advisory board. Debbie's the actual, Debbie's the CEO of the board. She's president of the board. So
it's
September 20th this year.
Okay.
Noon to 5, Golden Gate Park in Sharon Meadow. And it'll be a lot of fun. And I think I'm going to do it. I have a gig the night before in Mendocino. So I'm going to have to drive home from Mendocino on a Sunday, which is going to be a bitch. But
Sit on the board of Comedy Day. I'm going to stir up some feces right now. I'm going to accuse San Francisco of starting something they couldn't finish. I'm going to accuse.
I don't know. They've been doing it for 35 years.
Yeah, I'm going to go after my hometown. We okay. were there first in San Francisco. When did Comedy Day start?
1981.
This is what we did in San Francisco. And I say we because you were there. You came before I did. But we created the concept that you didn't have to be a corporate comic to make a living. And I'm going to hang on for 1 second, Will Durst. Okay. I'm going to give you a compliment, and then I'm going to rip you a new one, okay?
I'll take both of them.
Okay. All right. Early 80s, there was a club scene in New York City that started in 1974, 75. You always had the improv, and then you always had the improv, and then you had Catch a Rising Star. Those are for comics and cabaret acts, people who sang. You know, Bette Midler and Pat Benatar would perform at Catch a Rising Star and the Improv, not just comedians. And then you had Comic Strip opened up, and there were these showcase clubs. And in the early to mid-80s, when I was starting out, I looked around the scene in New York, and there was one purpose to stand-up comedy in the early 80s in New York, and that was to get on the Johnny Carson show. Because if you got on
Saturday Night Live.
Or Saturday Night Live. Because then you became an opening act on the road for a singer or a band, or you got to be a headliner. There were no comedy clubs in Middle America at the time.
There were a couple. In 1981, there might have been 20 full-time comedy clubs in the country. There were a couple in Chicago. There were a couple in L.A. There were a couple in San Francisco. There were a couple in New York. There were a couple in Boston. And then the comedy scene exploded with the rise of cable.
You're right. Jumping ahead.
All right, so what made you... Let me run this interview. Okay, so there we have David Feldman, Columbia journalism graduate, so you could write. You kind of knew show business. Now, why didn't you stay in New York, which is where, as our good friend Tom Rhodes is wont to say, one of the two places, along with L.A., where the cameras are plugged in? Why did you come to San Francisco instead of New York?
Because I thought I was a horrible human being and I needed basic training. I'd read about, like, the Marines. If you join the Marines, they'll break you down and then rebuild you. And I felt I needed to be rebuilt. I knew enough because I was in therapy even back then. I lacked empathy and had the wrong values. So I knew that I needed to just be broken down and rebuilt. And I thought I needed to do it in a place that...
Anonymously.
Not anonymously, because I was already anonymous in New York, but I needed to do it in a safe, loving space where people... and San Francisco was that place. That's where you go to be hugged. Larry Brown described me as a beaten dog. You know, twitching and all that kind of stuff. And I wanted to be accepted by you and Dr. Gonzo. I remember thinking, wow, if I could just no, hang out with Will Durst and Dr. Gonzo. I would be... And you had to prove that you were a good person to be accepted by the comedy community in San Francisco. It wasn't just about being funny. You had to be a good person because we went on long car rides together.
Northern California.
So if you weren't a good person, you weren't going to get stage time. And I thought, well, how do I get to be a good person? How do you, what does it mean to be a good person? Because no one ever taught me that in New York City. No one taught me how to be kind and empathetic. And I've heard somebody say about show business, it's all political. And I said, no, that's, you're cheapening show business. Show business isn't political. It's a car ride. And we're going to be on top of one another for a couple of hours. Are you going to get on my nerves? Because there are a million people who can do what I do and what you do. Are you going to get on my nerves? That's really what show business is. Are you there? Or did I get on your, or did I get on
your
nerves?
No, I get on people's nerves. Yeah. I get quiet.
Okay, so I came to San Francisco, and this is what I saw.
What year?
82.
82.
And this is what I saw. I went to the other cafe, and I saw Barry Sobel on stage, who I had never heard of. He had fans. Then I heard about you, who had fans, and Bobby Slayton, who had fans. And I remember at first being a New Yorker going, what do you mean fans? Who the hell are these people? They've been doing comedy for, you know, nanoseconds. What gives them the right to have fans? Jerry Seinfeld had the same reaction about San Francisco comics, right?
Seinfeld said that San Francisco comics were like the inhabitants of Shangri-La, that they would do fine as long as they stayed within the confines, but as soon as they tried to leave Shangri-La, they would turn into wizened, and you know it wouldn't work. And he was partly true, you know.
And Leno was kind of appalled when he came to San Francisco that there were local celebrities.
Oh, really?
Yeah. What's going on? Something. And I was not appalled, but I went, huh? You can get famous here in San Francisco? Well, in the early to mid 80s.
Well, the scene was such that, yeah.
It was the only place in America, possibly the world, where you could be a famous comedian and have a following without doing Johnny Carson, without being a movie star. It was the only place in the world where local comics were treated as heroes. Is that a fair statement?
Well, yeah, we were little rock stars.
Yeah.
And Bennett had a lot to do with it.
Alex Bennett, who won't do my show, but Alex Bennett had a... And Robin. Alex and Robin...
That's true. Robin brought a lot of people in.
But Alex had a daily morning show that highlighted comedians.
He made little stars.
Mm-hmm. And so there was a thing called...
But also he used us. I mean, he used us for his show. Because most... He created this whole format. Most radio shows that had comics on would have comics on for 5 minutes, half hour, an hour tops. You would join the show for an hour tops. And Alex made us stretch, and we would be on for 3 hours a day. We would co-host the show.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd come in at 7 and you'd work until 10, and then you go out and have breakfast, and he would buy you breakfast, and that was his way of repaying you. And we learned how to stretch that muscle of being funny for 3 hours, you know, at a shot, which is tough on the radio, you know. And he was like Johnny Carson. He would give it up. He knew that if people liked the Alex Bennett show, they wouldn't remember who got the laugh, who got the funniest joke of the day. That they just, oh, did you hear the Bennett show? So right. he was very instrumental in creating the Little Men, and he would run hot and cold. I remember Gonzo was his golden boy, and then he was banned from the show. And Slayton was a golden boy; he was banned from the show. Reuben was a golden boy; he was banned from the show. So, but they all came back into his good graces. So,
he had power issues. It was very great to me. So there was a thing called Comedy Day. Now, this doesn't sound like anything big these days, but when was the first Comedy Day?
81.
There was nothing like this anywhere in America. I don't know when Montreal started. Probably around the same time. Is that fair? The festival in Montreal?
Perhaps.
But in America, there was nothing like this. What was Comedy Day, and how big did it get?
Well, Comedy Day started as a dream of Jose Simone and Becky Irwin and I think
John Cantu.
And it started out in July of 81, and it was as many comics as we could fit onto the bill. We played at the Band Show. And then comedy started getting big. And in 1991, I think it started in 81, but it started getting so big that it outgrew the Band Show, and it moved to the Polo Fields. And Robin would come whenever he wasn't filming, if he wasn't on location. And Bobcat had just done the Police Academy movie, so he was huge. And Whoopi had been in a couple of movies, and they would do the show. I think they did it a couple, 3 years in a row.
Ellen.
And 1 year, in the Polo Fields, because of a convergence of comedy, you know, cresting as a wave, and also because of sponsorship, because Channel 2, Fox 2 would always do film us and then do a truncated version, an hour version, put it on TV. And the Chronicle was a sponsor. The Chronicle would run a full page ad once a week for the 6 weeks previous to Comedy Day. A full page ad with all the comics who were appearing with our faces, you know, in the ad. And then the week before Comedy Day, they ran the full page ad once a day. So I think in 90, 91 or 92, one of those years, we had 60,000 people at the Polo Fields of Golden Gate Park. And it was huge, and it was massive, and it was ugly, and it was hot, and it was magical.
It was magical.
You would always have one of the best sets.
Because I would be Hitler. This was my Hitler moment. I would look out, and I thought, this is my Nuremberg rally. I am going to speak before 50,000 people, 20,000 people. And I would get up there and just pretend I was Hitler. And I would, it was exhilarating. Are you still there?
I am.
And the other thing I remember, I'm blowing my own horn, but and of course you killed and everybody killed. The two things I remember about Comedy Day, my happiest moments were Comedy Day was, is he or isn't he? And he being?
Robin.
Yeah. And everybody, so in the back of my mind, I always knew that people were waiting for Robin. Is Robin Williams going to show up today? At the height of my powers as a stand-up comic, and we're talking 20 years ago when I was good, when I thought I was great, but in reality just good, I said, bring me up as Robin Williams. I said, let's create one of the great stories of stand-up. This will be, I'm going to do one of the great bombs of all time. And I said, just bring him up. Here he is, ladies and gentlemen, Robin Williams. And I would just walk out and go, how you doing? You know, and then try to do my act and make the comics love me for being a supreme asshole. And right before I went on, a moment of clarity. Swept over me, and I thought, to what end? Why would you do this? To get the other comics to love you? Is that really? Is this really? The other thing I remember was one of my sons had just learned to walk. And he stood in the wings waiting for me to go out. And I think there must have been 50,000 people there. And he doesn't understand this. He's just holding my hand. He can barely stand. And I go out and I do my stuff and I do pretty well. And then I go off stage and he runs onto the stage going, my turn, my turn. And I thought, you know, how fearless. I said, can you, you know, it was so hard for me to get up on stage and summon the courage. And here's this little 2-year-old running up in front of 50,000 people screaming, my turn, my turn, like no fear. How frightened were you when you first stepped on stage? I could not bring myself to stand on stage and tell jokes. I was terrified. Is it easier now to envision yourself as a stand-up? Do you think the comics today, and before we started, we were talking about how much better they are than we were when we were starting out. Do you think they have the fear that we had getting up on stage for the first time?
That's an interesting question. I know that I didn't have too much fear.
Really?
The hard part for me, no, because I approached it from so many different directions. You know, I had done musical theater, I had done community theater, I had done theater in high school and college, and I wrote for the school newspaper, and I wrote for the underground newspaper, and so I had investigated those skills. So it was a very small step. It wasn't a huge leap. You know, I built a ramp to that stage. So, there's a scene in Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead that a friend and I did, and that's almost a comedy routine. You know, we did it as a double act. So I had approached it from, it wasn't that big of a deal. But putting the first 7 minutes together, the first 5 minutes, that was a big deal.
And where did you get up on stage first?
I had a lot of fits and starts, but I would say in college at the age of 21, 1974, so 22 years old, a teacher at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee in the theater program named Herb Felsenfeld wanted us to do a performance.
Mr. Felsenfeld?
Herb Felsenfeld.
Mr. Felsenfeld? Professor Felsenfeld?
Professor Felsenfeld, who actually moved to San Francisco. He moved to San Francisco State.
Have you seen Professor Felsenfeld lately?
I have. He and his lovely wife, Gail. Yes. And so I, in this classroom at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, I bought a case of beer of long necks, and we used to have these stamped tin ashtrays in the student union, and I brought those into the class, and I shut down the banks of lights in the class, and I left the one where I was going to do my stuff on, and I sold beer, and I handed out ashtrays and encouraged them to smoke, and I did my 7 minutes. And
you sold beer?
And I actually made $3 on my first gig.
Wow.
Yeah, and then I had a set, and I went down to the local open mic, and we had a Monday open mic at a place called the Rusty Nail. I went on, and the first time I went on at the open mic, I was already like the third or fourth best one, you know, because I'd had stage time, and I knew how to write. And I remember there was one kid who was like 18 years old, and he had stolen a bit from a Bill Cosby album. And it was all about how it was when Cosby goes to Las Vegas. There's a mirror on the ceiling, so when he wakes up in the morning, he thinks he's being attacked by a naked skydiver, which is a funny joke.
Yeah.
But the kid told this verbatim from the album, and we all recognized, all the comics knew what was going on. But the audience didn't believe him because he was like 18. He didn't look like he was married. It didn't look like he's ever been to Vegas. They didn't buy any of his routine.
Was he white or black?
He was a white kid.
It's interesting. I took notes. I remember going to the Punchline, I guess it was 82 or 83, seeing the callbacks for the competition. And writing down, I have these notes somewhere, everything's in boxes now, of what I thought of certain comics, who I thought had it and who I thought didn't. This is before I even got up on stage. It was sexy. Stand-up was, I mean, I just remember, you know, back in the early 80s, you didn't take it for granted. If somebody who could summon the courage to get up on stage was sexy. It was powerful. I don't know if that is still present. I don't know if that force field of just...
Not as much, because the group of people who did it, like in the early 80s, you know, they were part of the baby boomer generation, and they were rocking. They were living in the 60s, you know, they were living in the 60s. Their version of what the, you know, the rock and rollers did, and the audience was the same thing. They were still on that high. And there were a lot of drugs being used back then. And there was an electricity about going to a comedy club. In the late 80s, you would walk in that and the Punchline would be dead packed on a Wednesday night. And people would see when the comics walked in and you hear like a little buzz and stuff.
Yeah.
And it's more commonplace now. Evening at the Improv, you know, it made it so... pedestrian.
It's more commonplace, and you know, fewer and fewer people are afraid to be put on television. It used to be a big thing to be on television. Now everybody's on television. I'm talking about people who have no showbiz ambitions. And I think the hecklers are better and less afraid of public speaking. Do you find that to be true?
I don't have many apples.
We have some fun premium content this week. I wanted Robert Smigel to do Donald Trump because he's famous for doing Donald Trump. And I was going to write something, and then I listened to something we did 3 years ago and thought, you know, we can't top this. So this week's premium content is Robert Smigel doing Donald Trump. $2.50 premium content. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Hit the premium content button. And you'll see Smigel as Trump, hysterical. $2.50. If you don't laugh your ass off, I'll give you your money back. You can get all our premium content for free by becoming a monthly subscriber for as little as $5 a month. We take all major credit cards. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Become a monthly subscriber. Join Team Feldo for only $5 a month, you gain access to all our premium content. Check it out.
Mr. Durst.
Mr. Feldman.
What happened to San Francisco? There is a phenomenon of comics who leave San Francisco, move to Los Angeles, and begin to hate San Francisco. Do you know about this phenomenon?
No.
Yeah, there's a phenomenon of comics, expats who leave San Francisco, go to Los Angeles, and really begin to seethe with anger that there's a place called San Francisco where it's cool during the summer and people are nice and nobody's asking you, what are you doing? What are you doing? And how gentle the audiences are. And we don't hate San Francisco. We just resent the fact that we're no longer there. That makes us angry.
You can't stay.
You can't stay. Now, is it fair to say that we, not you, but something went amiss in San Francisco, that there should have been a bigger, more vital scene that celebrated San Francisco's comedy roots? That there should have been a festival tied to Comedy Day, that there should have been...
Oh, sure, sure.
What happened?
That was a mistake. Limited vision. Limited vision. Keep it small. Keep it... we had a couple of club owners who had very tiny vision. They didn't see the big picture. They were very... satisfied with their own little fiefdoms.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, they spent all their time worried about little tiny incremental power struggles rather than seeing a larger picture. And a lot of it had to do with that, you know. And I'm talking about Tom Sawyer and John Fox, who they just didn't, you know.
And Alex Bennett. And anybody who had a fiefdom, that is my rap against San Francisco.
It's like that old joke about academic politics. Why is academic politics so brutal? Because so little is at stake.
Wow. Yeah, and that goes with another thing that Bobby Nickman told me. Remember Bobby Nickman?
No.
The comic, Bobby Nickman.
No.
He used to work for Bob Moore a lot. And now he's a comedy writer in sitcoms. But he told me, the shallower the pond, the meaner the fish. Listen, I love San Francisco. I'd be dead if it weren't for San Francisco. I don't think... I would have survived had it not been for San Francisco. Somebody said to me about San Francisco that it can only handle one trend at a time so that it could spawn the birth of rock and roll. I mean, there was rock and roll everywhere, but it really became a sanctuary for rock. And then that kind of didn't fade, but they got older. And then it was stand-up comedy. And there was always a sense in San Francisco of how long is this going to last? Is this a fad? And it became a self-fulfilling prophecy. There was
Clear Channel bought everything.
But even before that, there was this boom and bust mentality in San Francisco about stand-up being a fad. And we kept saying, how long is this going to last? How long is this going to last? And then it didn't last. Whereas in other parts of the country and the world, it's grown exponentially. I think it might have something to do with the geography of San Francisco. But the fad of the internet, which is to the south of San Francisco, Silicon Valley, they have... more of an infinite view of commerce. They don't see it as boom and bust. They just took on the world.
But their half-life is like 6 months, you know.
But nobody's saying how long is the internet going to last.
It's super attenuated. No, but all the individual players, I mean, you know, it's really a hothouse situation. And so that's what they created in San Francisco. And now San Francisco is it's a encapsulated little bubble. It's a techie terrarium, and because there's so much money.
You're not going to pull a Dominic Strauss-Kahn with your housekeeper? Are they knocking on the door?
No, but she's rolling her cart past me furiously.
Where is Cloverdale? Very quickly. Where is it?
Yeah.
Where is it?
Cloverdale is about 30 miles north of Santa Rosa.
It must be beautiful.
It is. A little hot, but it's beautiful.
Okay. Will Durst. To our listeners in Scotland, you can see him at the Edinburgh Festival. Give us the dates, the time, and the name of the show.
Yeah, it's See Me at the Fringe. And the show is called Boomer Raging from LSD to OMG. I'll be at the Gilded Balloon at 5:30 every day at the wine bar. So go to wildurst.com or Gilded Balloon. Okay.
And Wilder.
And thank you, buddy. Great talking to you.
Yes, we'll do it again real soon. Thank you, sir.
Sure.
That's our show. Our premium content this week is Robert Smigel doing Donald Trump. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Get all our premium content for free by becoming a monthly subscriber for as little as $5 a month. We accept all major credit cards. Thank you for listening.